back to Wombology Championship Sunday as we are now into our semi-finals. The top four, just four players left from our field of 16. I am Twitch Chat's favourite host, Callum Leslie, and with me, my favourite analyst, Sottle.
Hey, it's glowing testimony indeed, Callum. Thank you very much.
How are we doing?
I'm doing good. Excited about this first semi-final. Why don't you tell our avid viewers a little bit about what's about to go down here?
Well, I mean, this is the real underdog story of the tournament so far, right? Ryzen coming through Sho and Orage beating that Swedish pair. He now goes up against one of Europe's very best. Mm-hmm. Ryzen, of course, from your team, Complexity, the only North American player left in the bracket. Got a 3-0 victory over Orange with his Rogue as well, which was hugely impressive. But the Rogue has been left up here against 6-0. I'll take you through the lineups in just a second, but, you know, we talked about him all the way through the last 2 days. 6-0 is an absolute beast in this format, a beast in online tournaments, usually impressive ladder player. He's someone who has to be taken seriously as a threat to win this entire tournament.
Yeah, we both said, you said from day one that 6-0 was your favourite to at least reach the final from that top side of the bracket, and I predicted going into day two that the winner of 6-0 and Kranich would be my pick to win the tournament, so we both pegged a lot of hopes and expectations on 6-0 to do well in this tournament overall, and he's on course to doing that, but the obstacle that stands in his way right now, as you said, is Ryzen, who has been the surprise story of the tournament, which is not to dismiss him as a player. You know, he's not some sort of crazy unknown player. He's a big streamer, he has a big presence, he's on a big organization in Complexity, so he is a well-established player in the scene, but primarily known as a streamer and as a high-level rogue player, not as a successful competitive player so far.
Yeah, it's just to circle back a little bit to our last series, Hoy has just acknowledged his mistake on the Dr. Boom not being played. So he should have played the Peddler. Shouldn't have played Peddler before Dr. Boom.
Yeah, quite right.
But didn't get punished, so he's okay with it.
Yeah, sure.
We can see the lineups there. We have the Rogue, Warlock, and Druid for 6-0 with the Patron Warrior Band. I think, have we seen 6-0? Yeah, we saw 6-0 Druids. Did we see it against Kranich? No, we didn't see it against Kranich because he won. No, he did. Yeah, he won with the Druid 3-0.
Yes.
Against Kranich.
Yep.
So we'll see the Rogue and the Warlock from 6-0. And then from Ryzen, his Rogue, which he won 3-0 against Orange with, his Druid and his Paladin with his Warrior Band.
Yeah, so the other interesting thing we have here is that the Druid and the Rogue were the two decks, respectively, that 3-0'd in the previous round, and they've both been left up by the opponent here, both opting to ban out the Warrior. So we have a Rogue and Druid mirror match, with the flex there in the middle being Warlock against Paladin.
All right, well, here we go. It's going to be... was the Zoo of 6-0. The Zoo with the Bran Bronzebeard, and I believe the Gormok as well.
Yeah. Bran, Zoo, very low curve. Tops out at 5 with the Doomguard and Lotheb, I believe. And, just Bran to take advantage of all those extra battle cries, like the Gormok, but also Abusive Sergeant, Defender of Argus, Dark Peddler, etc.
And Ryzen starting with his Rogue. I'm a fan of Ryzen starting with his Rogue, particularly having come into that momentum of getting a 3-0 victory with it. He's very comfortable with it. He feels like that is probably his best deck in the entire game. So yeah, open up with that and see what you can get done with it.
Right, I mean, he's got that momentum train going, right, with the Rogue from the previous series. So why not stick with what was working? Both of these players starting out very quickly here, both understanding what they want to do in the matchup in the early turns, playing their options out very quickly. 6-0 starting to establish a little irritating board, but I like Ryzen's Van Cleef and Preparation Keep in this matchup because it gets him to generate a massive minion on the board straight away here, and that's exactly what he's going to do. 6-6 Van Cleef on turn 3, eviscerates the 2-2 out of the way. So this is one of the ways that Rogue can really fight back early in this matchup. If there's no Power Overwhelming or at all IMB Cowl in your opponent's hand, you usually get away with this, and since the minion left on board here is so low power, even the Power Overwhelming wouldn't be good enough.
Yeah, I mean, I don't see any way for even if he tapped into the Power Overwhelming, he wouldn't be able to play the Power Overwhelming and the Direwolf.
Yeah.
So that's, yeah, pretty bad situation for 6-0 here, staring down this Van Cleef. Does have Implosion in hand as well to deal with it in turns down the line, but that 6-6 is going to be able to get some work done.
It is. The only irritating thing here, I guess, is that the 1-3 is left up on board, but that backstab is a huge draw with the Violet Teacher.
Oof.
So much tempo here. Takes out that Knife Juggler, which was a threat right now of being able to deal with that 6-5 Van Cleef. With the extra knife you get from the Haunted Creeper alongside just its 3 power itself, that was what 6-0 felt was his best chance of dealing with it. Needs a 3 here. Doesn't get it!
Gets the 2. I mean, this is the kind of game I was talking about before, where 6-0 This is the kind of game 6-0 concedes it from this kind of hell. Fan okay. of knives.
That's hilarious. And my outburst of laughter there has nothing to do with the fact this is my complexity teammate getting this run of insane luck in game one here. I just find it hilarious when stuff like this happens to not me.
Yeah. And it's kind of amusing when it happens to 6-0 as well, because it's all, I don't know, it's always fun to watch him react, but it is a shame.
Poor 6-0, honestly.
He got a pretty good start as well, but it was just that Pret Van Cleef keep from Ryzen. It shows his experience with the deck. He kept those in his mulligan and was able to make use of them.
Yeah, as time's gone on, I think Prep is a card that rogue players keep more and more in almost every matchup, but the combination with Prep and Edwin Van Cleef against Zoo in particular is just so powerful, because you get to just be aggressive with that huge minion early and just challenge everything they play.
So you have the sap in hand here if you're Ryzen. Mm-hmm. Is there any consideration to sapping the 1-3, or in fact deadly poisoning down the 1-3 and sapping the 2-4 and then just going face?
That is the play that I'm looking at personally, yeah. I think that's the right line here.
Gonna push that aggression.
Exactly. And it's the mana is too low from your opponent to worry about the high value sap targets. Looks like there is actually a Dr. Boom in 6-0's deck though. I erroneously said that it probably topped out at 5.
Oh.
Just got top decks on the brain. Looks like he is trading with the 1-1 just to remove maybe Power Overwhelming as a possibility. And with that 6-2 on board, even a small buff like Direwolf Alpha that we see in hand or an Abusive Sergeant would be able to take it out. So it makes a lot of sense too.
Does 6-0 go for the... Oh, he's going to go for the second implosion here on the Violet Teacher.
Yeah, I actually really like that from 6-0. He knows he needed a huge swing there to make up for the slight... scamming that he got early on with the first one rolling two, so he accepted that he needed to get the big roll later on implosion, so he played to his out, knows that just taking care of the Edwin wouldn't have been good enough. So
all right, well, that's a quick game one, a quick 1-0 victory for Ryzen. 6-0 coming up against some pretty crazy stuff there from Ryzen. I mean, obviously the keeping the Prep Van Cleef was huge, but it was the backstab pickup and then the Fan of Knives pickup the next turn.
Yeah, combined with the implosion low roll, the backstab and the backstab into the Fan of Knives chain draws was just exactly perfect against the board that was presented to him. That knife juggler on its own would have been such a huge swing with the implosion follow up, and there was no real answer to it in hand right before that. He had the sap, but sapping such a low value minion is not a fantastic idea most of the time. So the backstab coming off the top was perfect. Allowed that Violet Teacher to be developed as well, since it's a zero mana card. And that was the beginning of the end from 6-0.
Well, 6-0 is going to go on to his Druid, which, of course, he got the 3-0 with. So we're looking at two decks which are undefeated on day two. Ryzen's Rogue at 4-0, 6-0's Druid at 3-0.
Yep.
One of them is going to go down here for the first stack.
Again, has that Prep in his opening hand. Two of them is probably a little bit ambitious. You probably want to dedicate one of those slots to a more impactful individual card. But again, I'd love to see him keep one Prep in his opening hand here for sure.
What about the Living Roots here for 6-0? Are those useful cards for him to keep in the early game?
They are weak in this matchup early in particular. They do tend to just get traded out by the hero power early on, but the thing is, you know, they are one mana cards, so although they are flexible late on, they are still at their most effective early, so you probably want to keep at least one of them just so you remove them from being potential draws that you get later in the game.
There's a sap to help deal with anything that's innervated. That's actually a pretty big pickup for Ryzen, because if there was some kind of crazy double innervate play, like a double innervate Thorazin, you can effectively trade your sap for both innervates.
Right.
And you would take that.
Yeah, you'd definitely take that. 6-0 just goes right ahead and innervates the Shredder here. Decides not to wait for the more stable curve of Innovate Drake into Piloted Shredder. Just Piloted Shredder is a much harder minion for Rogue to deal with. So, you know, the advantage of playing a 4-4 next turn in terms of tempo compared to playing a Piloted Shredder this turn, which is much more difficult to deal with, is a significant advantage.
Ryzen's going to prep the Fan of Knives here, and then, yeah, look at the sap for the 4-2. Like I said, with the Innervate play, 6-0 not happy to see that. So, yeah, the Innervate just effectively wasted for 6-0.
And now nothing to do this turn. Feels bad, man. Hero power faced on turn 3 after using an Innervate. So turns out that going for the more solid curve of Drake on 3 followed by Shredder on 4 would have worked out a little bit better. But can't blame Sixo for trying to take the risk there, be aggressive, rush the Rogue down as quickly as possible.
Yeah, Ryzen really showing his mettle as a Rogue player here. Just equipping that deadly poison this turn. Sixo playing a Shredder quicker than we could change the perspective there.
Yeah.
These two players are both playing very quickly.
Oh, baby. He's going to coin Loeth up here. He could also coin Eviscerate Van Cleef to get the board clear and a 6-6 in play. It looks like he's just going to go for the Loeth up play here instead. So. Kind of interesting. Okay. Interesting.
As Drake picks up an Ancient of Lore, turn too early, made a backstab. Well, there is potential for backstab Eviscerate Van Cleef.
There is. He turned down the 6-6 Van Cleef on the previous turn, though. Coin Eviscerate on the first half of the Shredder. You have a very high likelihood of your dagger being able to deal with the second half of the Pilot Shredder.
Right.
And then Van Cleef on the board is a 6-6. So he turned it down on the previous turn, and it was a cleaner turn then than it is now with that Nerubian Egg in play. But of course, the Nerubian Egg coming out of the Shredder would have been pretty awesome for him that turn, honestly, with... You know, zero power minion on board, he could have even just kept the deadly poison charge and had his 6-6 in play, but now he just doesn't really have enough targets for the backstab and Avis here, but unless he wants to take care of the egg, which looks like he's going to do, he's going to backstab Avis, one of the targets, trade the Loeth Ebb into the other and just get a 6-6 on board. He's good.
Yeah, we'll see if he trades it. I think he probably should. Yeah, he is going to do that.
Yeah.
Alright, so yeah, 5-1 and 6-6. Wrath picked up. Is pretty good. So yeah, you can silence and then Wrath, and that will deal with what's on board.
Yep.
Another Ancient of Lore picked up.
Yes.
So Sixo will be able to build up some card advantage.
Right, cycled himself straight into double lore there, so he's set up nicely, not only for the next two turns, but because of the extra resources that he's going to get for the next several turns after that as well. But Ryzen as well has his, pretty much his equivalent in the deck, which is the double Azir Drake to keep him going as well.
Poking away face. Roots not too impactful. I think this is a pretty easy Ancient of Lore here. Though there is a consideration for swipe, I guess, and clearing this board. How scared are you of that Azure Drake?
Yeah, Drake is a minion that does command a large amount of respect, particularly from Rogue, but the sacrifice that you make to remove it compared to developing a 5-5 on the board and playing two cards, you've already seen one Fan used, you've already seen one Abyss used, you've already seen a backstab being used, so it's a lot of the potential spells already out of the deck.
This is the double MC Tech Druid from Sixo, right?
Yes.
Yes, we see the first one of those coming to hand. Ryzen is going to go ahead and use that final charge. Mostly, so, a lot of that is so he can fit the dagger up into his mana here.
Mm-hmm.
Gives him the opportunity to do things with Oil and Poison next turn and Violet Teacher. And of course, double Drake on the board. This is pretty scary for Sixo.
It is, yeah. This is now significantly scary than the previous turn with the double spell power buff. But again, like the clear turn here sacrifices such a large amount of tempo and resource gain with the Ancient of Lore. But it looks like he is going to decide that he has to respect this board this time. Does get to develop a minion this time with the Keeper of the Grove, and he's just going to go with the Living Roots and the Mind Control tech play. We'll see if he decides to respect this single Drake again, or whether he goes face. He is going to respect it this time.
Okay, well the combo is in hand, obviously, and it is coming up to turn 9 for Sixo, so Ryzen is going to need to do something here.
This guy's
tough. How much damage there is? It's 14.
It's 23.
Yep, that is enough. So Sixo gonna do druid things.
These players are playing so fast here, by the way. I can understand, yeah. Like Ryzen's comfort with Rogue means that, you know, he is probably playing a little bit quicker than a lot of players would. Probably played as many Rogue games as anyone, so he's comfortable in what play he wants to make. But Sixo as druid is matching that pace as well, just rapidly like progressing the state of the game.
I'm getting a little bit out of breath, to be honest. I'm not fit enough for this testing. This is why I do Hearthstone and not CSGO.
Right. But yeah, ties up the game there to 6-0, 1-1, comes back with the Druid, so the battle of the two undefeated decks goes in favor of the Druid, and 6-0's Druid remains undefeated for the day, at least. So he is now 4-0 with that Druid, and Ryzen is going to have to find an answer for it here, and his options are, I believe, Paladin and...
Druid.
Paladin and Druid, of course.
And he's going for the Paladin.
He's going for the Paladin. Okay, this is a matchup that I've heard a lot of dispute from between individual players. I personally believe the Paladin has a decent edge, maybe a 5% edge in this matchup, 55% favored, something like that. But I've seen some very accomplished Druid players say that they feel that the Druid is actually favored if you're playing the right list. Living Roots are huge. Big Game Hunter is such a huge swing if it comes down. You do have the opportunity to just be really aggressive in the early game if you do get that strong draw with a Living Roots early into into a Shade or an Innovate Shredder or something along that line. So it's definitely a matchup that can go either way, but Ryzen makes his feelings clear here by picking the Paladin over the 50-50 mirror match with the Druid. So he obviously feels like it's a favorable matchup for him.
Yeah, we'll see if the double extra one.
I will fight with honor.
That just played a crap load more one drops, really. Abusive Sergeants and Lepinomes and things on top
of it. Yeah, it was effectively, it was Aggro Paladin with Mysterious Challenger.
With Mysterious Challenger and Secrets in it, yeah. So. But
it's interesting
now,
the evolution of Secret Paladin, because you know, we see Secret Keeper now as an auto include in the deck, but that was originally only in the aggro version.
Yeah,
the control version didn't used to play the Secret Keeper.
Yeah, the control version.
Well, there was a more controlling version as opposoed to the Secret Keeper.
I know what you mean. It's just amusing hearing this referred to as a control deck.
The control version. Yes. It's a contextual thing.
Yes, I know. What was I talking about? Divine Favor. So yeah, but now the curve is a lot more stable. It plays much more high value minions. You tend not to run out of cards as often, and even when you do, your top decks are so dense that you often feel like you don't need a Divine Favor. So it has the potential to be such a dead card. But in the meantime, those two innovates in 6-0's opening hand turned out to be pretty damn good here.
Yeah, he's playing pretty quickly though, and I'm not sure. I wouldn't. What do you think about the Azure Drake, though, instead? Keeping an Innervate.
What?
We could have played the Azure Drake that turn instead.
Right. Why?
Because the Thorison isn't hitting. Well, it's only hitting the swipe and the Azure Drake.
But it's it's also a 5-5 instead of a 4-4, and it discounts the rest of your hand, so you can just coin out the Drake next turn anyway.
Yeah.
I think, yeah, just, like, the Emperor here isn't necessarily about discounting these cards in hand, it's just about getting the biggest thing on board that you can so you can start fighting back and being aggressive. So, yeah, I'm definitely a big fan of getting out the 5-5 here instead. And he does have that Drake as a follow-up, which means that one additional card gets discounted. And the Big Game Hunter being the card that is dealt with here, or is discounted here, sorry, is actually quite a big deal, because he now gets to potentially squeeze more into his Challenger counter turn if he does get that Big Game Hunter to line up.
It goes for the Muster for Battle to get a full board clear rather than the Pilot and Shredder. But there is a swipe, a 2-mana swipe that can punish this. He can 2-mana swipe and Wild Growth this turn.
Yeah, it was interesting because before the Wild Growth was drawn, he had the decision to make about valuing 2 of his health versus 4 of his opponents, or 3 of his opponents, because he can choose to swipe face and Hero Power the mini-bot, or he can swipe the mini-bot and Hero Power face. And both of those have their merit, but I think as the Druid, you kind of consider yourself the aggro in this matchup, as weird as it seems. It's kind of your job to get things done and kill your opponent before they get too much of an imposing board that you can't deal with. So I think I would have gone with a swipe face and Hero Power the mini-bot, but the Wild Growth makes that all a bit of a formality, and in fact he's even going to decide not to use the swipe here, just telegraph the swipe to his opponent by slapping down that mini-bot.
Oh, Shredder comes down right in the middle. And, I mean, the swipe is still good here, it doesn't mean you can't swipe the face.
Yeah.
You wait. I guess you see what the Shredder drop is, but yeah, the second Wild Growth is pretty nice, but he needs some card draw here.
Yeah, and it may seem weird to see this Pilot Shredder dropped into such an obvious swipe from your opponent. It feels like you're giving up the first part of the Shredder for nothing, but first off, it lets you keep tempo on the board by having a minion in play. Secondly, that minion in play is of extremely high value because you're about to play Mysterious Challenger, so you want to make sure there is an additional target for Competitive Spirit to hit and for Avenge to potentially hit so that your Challenger isn't vulnerable to Big Game Hunter.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say. Playing that to the turn before Challenger. Lore is a nice pickup, but you can be pretty sure it's playing into Repentance, unfortunately.
Yeah, since you see the full tree, Repentance is almost certainly one of those secrets. You will be playing a 7-mana Magma Rage at this turn.
So is the play here hero power to trigger the noble sack and hope the avenge hits the challenger so you can BGH and then you hit the repentance with the BGH as well?
That is definitely a possible play, but he can choose to go with, he can choose to go with the force of nature instead, which gives him a lot more flexibility in terms of how he wants to react to things here.
Yeah, that's right. So you can kill the, if you get the right avenge here, you can kill the Stormmaster as well.
Yep, got
BGH
him.
Is green.
BGH is green.
Gotta play it. Well, it's not green. It should be yellow if the case was if it did that, which it doesn't.
So repentance hits the 4-2 instead of the 5-5. Much better outcome here. Big swing on the board. Full board clear. 4-1 in play. But challenger number two is going to come down here, and we're going to get to see exactly how many copies of additional secrets he's playing in his deck. He's also Finley Murgleton in the deck.
Yeah, that's not that common.
It's not. It's much more common in the outright aggressive paladins. The Zoo Paladin and the Face Paladin tend to play Finley. To try and get a more aggressive hero power than the 1-1 generator, but a lot of the time, Secret Paladin is usually pretty happy to be able to make 1-1s with that button because of the Blessing of Kings, the Keeper of Alderman, the Mysterious Challenger pulling all the secrets, etc., that plays better with friends. So a bit of a little twist from Ryzen on the deck there, but now that he's free of so many secrets, he's free to play the Ancient of Lore here. Competitive Spirit does now go off, representing a decent amount of power on the board, but...
So there's only 6 secrets in this deck, right? There's Tyrion off the top. Wow, okay. So what is that last secret for Ryzen? Because I assumed that was going to be...
There's 7. A Noble Sacrifice was played early. So that Noble Sacrifice was already gone. Right. 5 were summoned from the first challenger, and then that only left the second Avenge for the second challenger.
Yeah, and Competitive Spirit was in hand when Challenger was played?
Spirit was played, but the board was cleared immediately after the Challenger turn, so it didn't activate. Just now, which is why we see the 7-7 and the 2-4.
Yeah, I couldn't see it when the board was cleared because of the overlay, unfortunately. This is looking pretty rough for 6, so his undefeated deck might be about to suffer a defeat in its own right.
Very much looking that way, yeah. The Hunter Hero Power is pushing through extra damage. He can put up the Taunt Wall here with the Druid of the Claw, but that's not going to be good enough. The Hero Power will pull him 1 damage out of range, but the Keeper of Alderman, in fact, represents all that Ryzen needs here to finish the game.
Yep. That's going to be it. Ryzen is going to jump out to a 2-1 lead game point.
So the 6-6 Tyrion goes into the taunt here, you Keeper your Finley to push it up to 1 extra damage, and then that's a total of 12 to face with the 7-7, the 3-3, and the Hero Power.
Yep, just to make sure he sees it.
It's actually not the most obvious thing in the world, because your default reaction would be to try and Keeper the taunt. You think that was the way you got the most damage, but that doesn't actually change anything. You have to Keeper your own minion to get the +1 damage, so...
You also need to make sure you're not a scrub and you are actually calculating your new hero power with your new hero power rather than your original one.
So, you know, you'd expect any reasonable Hearthstone player to spot that, but it's a little bit obtuse because your natural reaction would be thinking, okay, awesome, I can Keeper that taunt, but that actually doesn't achieve anything in that situation.
Alright, well, the Druid of 6-0, and that leaves the Rogue, which should be decent against the Paladin.
Yeah, Rogue is definitely one of the decks that feels okay coming up against Secret Paladin. Now you're looking at like Patron Warrior, Freeze Mage, Oil Rogue. These are the decks that tend to do okay against the ladder terror that is Secret Paladin. So probably pretty confident queuing in the Rogue here.
And then the Druid of Ryzen is the final deck. So 6-0 has the Rogue to beat the Paladin and the Druid.
Very doable. It's one matchup that's almost certainly a little bit in his favor against the Secret Paladin, and then a matchup that there is a hot debate over amongst people who's favored, but still very winnable for the Rogue, regardless of who you talk to. So he does have to win 2 games here, but neither of them are hugely unfavored, so he does still have an opportunity to come back from behind here.
All right, well, let's see. 6-0 is going to have to pick the Rogue is his last deck into the Paladin of Ryzen. Of course, Rogue is slightly favored against Secret Paladin, but Secret Paladin, like Druid, the reason why those two decks, you know, we were discussing Firebat's tier list yesterday. He puts Paladin and Druid above everything else in their own tier, and everything else is kind of similar.
Yeah.
And the reason for that, primarily, I think, is that really they can get the win against just about anything.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any other deck which you can say can beat anything quite easily.
Patron Warrior, probably, with the right draw, is just too destructive.
Right.
Even in the new form, where you're, you know, so if you get the right draw with just enough early cycle, like a bunch of Acolytes and Death Spites and Inner Rages, that draw can just tempo anything out of the game while drawing like three cards every turn. So no one is able to keep up with that. But those are very much the three decks, I think. But yeah, it's a shame that those decks tend to be the mid-rangey just curve decks where you just play your dudes every turn in the case of a Paladin and Druid. I would like to see a format where the stronger decks are a little more involved than that. I'd love to be casting tournaments where there was just a ton of Freeze Mage and Oil Rogue and Patron and crazy combo decks. This is what we have. We have Paladin and Druid and a lot of it, so I guess we just have to suck it up and take it here. And we see that 6-0 is also, in fact, playing the Divine Favor.
No, that's Ryzen.
Oh, sorry, that is still Ryzen. What am I talking about?
Yep.
Yeah.
It's because the perspectives are changing really quickly
fast. But, like, it's still dumb, because obviously, it's last hero standing. Ryzen's obviously sticking on the deck. But definitely a potential for that Divine Favor to get some value here, because we might even see a prep sprint happening at some point in the near future. That Violet Teacher will probably change things, though. Gonna go ahead and activate the secrets here. Noble Sack is activated. If it was in case it was Avenge, he could have used the prep sap to sap the Avenge target. So he checks first to find out what's going on. He's gonna decide here whether he wants to use his preparation. And since he doesn't, he's able to be answered straight away with that Blessing of Kings.
Yep, Blessing of Kings here cleans up the Violet Teacher. Yeah, sorry, there was a second there where I thought the arrow was pointing at face.
Yeah, that was the arrow of the second creeper that was going face.
Yeah.
It did look for a second like he was about to go face.
Yeah. 6-0 is going to get the sap on this 5-3. So, yeah, no prep sprint here, which is what I think Ryzen will be hoping for, actually, so he can find favor into it. Lothep is going to come down this turn more than likely, though. You know, something like Haunted Creeper Conkhammer is also an option. But Lothep just contests the spells, obviously, and contests his board really well.
Yep. From 6-0 side, probably not going to worry too much about this Lothep. Just going to let it do its thing for one turn. Imagine we'll just take out the 1-1 here and just go face. Well, chose to keep both his dagger charges up there and trade with the 3-4. I guess because it was going to get immediately traded out by the Lothep anyway, he figured he might as well get some value out of it before it did that.
Right. Yeah, that's interesting. So how do we deal with these secrets if we're 6-0?
Excellent question. So he attacks in. He can either make a 8-4 or a 9-8. If it's the 8-4, he has a pretty nice play with the Eviscerate to deal with it. The 9-8 becomes a slightly different problem, but he can still trade into it quite nicely using his board. So potentially Backstab and Fan of Knives would take it down to 5. So he'd then get to trade in his 5-4. He's probably looking for a way to trade the 3-1 instead. So we'll probably see the Backstab Eviscerate get used here, maybe.
Yeah, so he can use the 3-1 if he does the Backstab Eviscerate.
Whoa!
Oh, gets a second Backstab. That's not going to be too useful for him here just now.
So is he just going to double trade the minions in here, or is he going to... What's happening? He's going to use the Backstab, trade with the 5-4.
He's trading with the slime, yeah.
Yeah, and the 5-4. No, ropes out. Nope. He got it in. All right. Okay.
Sometimes not the easiest thing to tell.
Yep, so Secret Keeper, Avenge, Redemption... okay, so you can play Secret Keeper, Avenge, Haunted Creeper, and then still have the mana to use Divine Favor. So you would have 2 cards in hand, and your opponent has 7. So it'd be 5 cards drawn this turn.
Seems pretty good.
Yeah.
So you play the Avenge rather than Redemption, right? Obviously.
Yep, seems a lot better. Although the Redemption has some value with the Haunted Creeper in play for sure, but it's a more potentially high value secret later on when you get things like Tyrion and Sludge Belchers and Dr. Boom, etc. in play.
Oh, Tyrion into turn 8. I was just about to say the draw is not hitting those high value minions for Ryzen, but gets the Tyrion perfectly on time.
Yeah. and a sap already used by by 6-0. No second sap in hand just yet, but the downside of the Divine Favor play there, if you are to find one, and it's very hard to find one because he did just draw five cards, I think that's it, is that he didn't make the most aggressive play on the board as he could have done, so there is a chance for the Rogue to get significantly ahead of the board on tempo right now.
Yeah, so it looks like SI7 into Fan of Knives, would assume.
Yeah, seems like the play. But he's just considering now the implication of Avenge. He's just realized that this is going to be a problem here. So he's going to backstab here to set the Avenge off, and then the SI can be used to take that +2 buff off of something that gets buffed. Yeah, so he's going to go ahead and SI the thing that gets buffed, Fan of Knives away, but... Yeah, 6-0's original plan here, maybe as a product of how fast this series is being played. You can see 6-0's original plan, he quickly realized wasn't going to work out. Had to adjust to use the backstab as well.
Yeah, you could see he was almost chastising himself a little bit for playing, for not thinking that through and playing a little bit too quickly. Mm-hmm. This is interesting, going for the True Silver rather than the Tyrion.
I don't mind it because... He wants to ideally play Tyrion in a position where he's not behind on the board, so if the second sap is in hand, 6-0's forced to sap in a situation where he doesn't also have a board alongside it. So these minions in play now alongside the True Silver means that he potentially gets to deal with whatever happens this turn, and then he can play Tyrion against an empty board.
Well, the sap has now been picked up, so Ryzen did well to play around that sap then.
Yeah.
Obviously, the sap's not going to be in hand for when he does want to play Tyrion.
Right. But yeah, the plan here was just to develop the board as best he can. He still has that competitive spirit in play, which incentivizes him playing multiple minions as well. And this line is going to help him control the board a bit more for when he does eventually want to play Tyrion. He might even decide not to do it here. You know, things like Pilot Shredder, Coghammer here are perfectly fine. Even Consecration for 9 mana is not the most ridiculous thing in the world here.
Do you think he wants to maybe play the Finley here as well and get to an aggressive hero power and see if that can help him?
Definitely a consideration. There's a lot of possible lines. Like I said, Pilot Shredder and then Coghammer after making all the trades so you can potentially refresh the Divine Shields on the minibot is a line that you could go down as well with a hero power. And the Consecration is genuinely a serious consideration here for 9 mana. It's a really good Consecrate. It does cost 9, which is the downside, but this is about as good a Consecrate as you're probably ever going to get. So he is just going to go ahead and slam the Tyrion here. He is able to fight into most of this board here, so the sap coming down isn't going to be the end of the world. He's sapping with only a 1-1 in play. Oh, he's not going to respect the 5-5, though.
Ooh, is he going to have time to choose the hero power? Gets the mage hero power.
We don't know, because I believe it defaults to the left-hand side one when you rope out anyway.
Oh, really?
So he may have just got really lucky there that probably was just the best choice in that situation.
It was mage, shaman, and...
Warrior.
Warrior, okay. Yeah. I didn't even get a chance to see all three of them. That's quickly it disappears.
So yeah, he may have just got lucky that the best one was just on the left-hand side there. It may have been default picked by the rope.
It's the second player we've seen potentially caught out a little bit by the timing of Discover.
Yeah. So Dr. Boom's sap gonna come down here. And by leaving that 5-5 up, he is allowing 6-0 a little bit of extra tempo here. He could have chosen to take care of it, meaning that the 5-5 wouldn't have been in play to defend a sap, but I guess he's trying to just push through lethal as aggressively as he possibly can here. And so he has 7 damage. 9, 11, 12 damage in total, I believe. Yeah. He's 1 damage off lethal, right? 3, 6, 7, 2 from the Coghammer is 9, 2 from the Consecrate is 11, and then 1 from the Ping is 12.
Yeah, he does have the damage in hand, but doesn't have the mana to do it.
Right. Keeper of Older Man adds the same amount of damage as Coghammer or Consecration, so you can do any combination of those three cards, plus a Ping, and you still come out at 12. So you're going to end up having to use a defensive Keeper of Older Man here more than likely to get rid of this Dr. Boom.
Which doesn't feel too bad when you do have those, as you say, those other cards which do the same amount of damage. Move quickly.
He's going to go for the Consecrate Hero Power line here, attacks everything else to face first, pings the Dr. Boom, Consecrates to clear out the board. Himself in really good shape here.
See where these Boombots land.
And Divine Shield, and one to the biggest health minion.
0 and 1 is the damage on those Boombots.
Yeah. I mean, that Blade Flurry draw looks really good for 6-0. I mean, having had the Divine Shield pop, that is a really good out for him to be able to clear the board. The problem that he encounters now, however, is that Tyrion is going to come down with no sats in play, but the Blade Flurry is going to put him down to 9, which is enough. So if he plays Tyrion here, he's dead to the Azure Drake double eviscerate.
And he can eviscerate now if he wants to.
He can.
Doesn't really make a difference.
It doesn't play around Lothep either way, because you still won't be able to combo the second eviscerate. You need to combo it specifically with spell power. So you need to be able to play Azir Drake eviscerate. The Blood Mage is already gone.
Yeah.
It doesn't play around Lothep to do it now, but I guess he feels like he just might as well at this point.
Second True Silver is an out either way, right?
Okay, sure. If Ryzen has second True Silver, then by eviscerating now, he gives himself more options. Say if he draws a deadly poison off the Azure Drake, he can Drake, eviscerate face, dagger up, deadly poison.
Right. Yeah, so eviscerating now is slightly better if there's a second True Silver.
Agreed.
And he's just going to Tyrion, but... Oh, yeah, the redemption feels good on the Tyrion, but 6-0 has the Drake eviscerate. He's going to get the win here and level this series up. 2-2.
Yeah, beautiful stuff. That Blade Flurry top deck the turn before turned out to be a much bigger deal than I expected it to be, because once you evaluated it, it seemed like it was going to be bad. The Tyrion came down straight afterwards, but he just had that damage in hand with the double Abyss to make the Tyrion irrelevant. So really good navigation of the game there from 6-0. Ties the series up to 2-2, and this one is going all the way down to the wire.
Well, we are in the top four. You would expect these players to be very skilled and be taking each other to the very limit. 6-0's Rogue, of course, needs to get 2 wins for him to seal this series. He's already got 1, and it's going to be the Druid of Ryzen versus the Rogue of 6-0 to decide this series.
Yep, and it's a great matchup to end the series with, a matchup that is heavily disputed between players as to who comes out on top, but we'll just have to wait and see if Ryzen has what it takes here. 6-0's been looking very good with the Rogue so far.
What's your personal opinion on the matchup?
On Druid versus Rogue?
Yeah.
I like Rogue. I think if you know how to mulligan in the matchup, you can fairly consistently get the kind of tempo plays that you need early. And if you're able to swing the board once, fully swing the board once, you know, Violet Teacher prep sap on a Shredder kind of level of swing, then Druid just struggles so much to come back from that situation.
Yeah, I mean, as long as the matchup isn't super unfavored for the Rogue, whenever it's a player that I know has played a ton of Rogue and is really good at the deck, I always favor that player, just because they know their outs and they know the matchup so well.
Yeah.
So if it's someone like a 6-0 or a Firebat or or Ryzen now, from what I've seen from his Rogue play, honestly.
Yeah.
There are some players where you think they could just beat anyone with their Rogue play.
Yeah, and it's something I talked about a lot yesterday, less so today, about decks that have a big gap between the skill floor, like the lowest acceptable level that you can play the deck well, and the skill ceiling, which is the absolute optimal level of play. Decks like Rogue and Freeze Mage, etc., have a much bigger gap between those two things than things like Paladin and Druid do. So you have more of a range as a player to be able to just straight up outplay your opponent with those decks than you do with a Secret Paladin or a Druid.
Ryzen instantly mulliganed there and kept the Innervate Shade.
Innervate Shade seems good, but 6-0 does have that prep in his opening hand, so that is the key piece that you need to make the big swing happen. But Shade Naxxramas is a great drop from Druid, because it's one of the minions that's immune to that big swing from the Rogue early on. It's a minion that's very, very hard to interact with, and unless they get something super early on, like Blood Mage prep Fan of Knives on turn 2 or something ridiculous.
Yeah, we talked about that yesterday, I think it was, that it's really good against Rogue because you do have to have something insane like Thalnos prep Fan of Knives, or you have to have Azure Drake fan, or you have to have, you have to have a huge amount straight away to deal with it.
Yeah.
And it takes it even just a couple of turns to get very far out of range.
Yeah, if you get it down on turn 1 or turn 2 with the coin or something like that, then unless your opponent does have that immediate answer that usually involves prep, it very quickly outgrows the Blade Flurry. So unless there's a huge Blade Flurry later on with, say, Deadly Poison and a Tinker Oil, then you start to enter sort of Immortal Shade territory.
Yeah, so you see the 6-0 would need a Flurry now.
Right.
With the Deadly Poison. and the prep.
And the prep, yeah. Yeah. It would still be a huge resource burn just to get rid of this shade, but now that it's grown to 4-4, it's starting to get to that point where it's more or less immortal unless we see a huge Tinker Oil Flurry come down.
Six does pick up a sap, but we saw in the reverse of this game earlier on when Ryzen was on the Rogue that the ability to sap the Innervated Out card was really impactful for the Rogue, as you effectively just burn those Innervates. 6-0 has picked up the sap, but unfortunately, there's not a big Innervated Out minion for him to target.
Yeah, and you see the exact thing that I talked about early on, which is why the Shade is a great minion to have early. If any other minion was in play there, we would have seen exactly the Violet Teacher prep sap that I talked about as a key point in the matchup early on. So yeah, the fact that it was exactly Shade here is huge. The fact that he's able to finish off the... follow it up with Lotheb is also huge because it potentially allows him to ignore this Violet Teacher for a turn, but he may also decide just to respect it and reveal the Shade here since it's kind of safe from removal with the Lotheb in play anyway.
Yeah, he's going to go ahead and do that, which I like.
Yep.
There's going to be a Belcher probably.
6 mana Deadly Poison. Feels bad, man.
Yeah, I mean, the first part of the Belcher just dies to the Shade straight away. If you want to go down that route, you can just silence it and go face.
Yep.
If Ryzen wants to be super aggressive here.
Yeah, it is a little bit awkward. You have an important decision to make here, because if you trade off with the 5-5, which seems like the natural trade, suddenly your board is exposed to Blade Flurry again. Whereas if you trade with the 6-3, you're kind of just giving up an entire minion for free by respecting a card that your opponent might not have. So you have to really consider your opponent's outs here and how bad, for example, them having Blade Flurry is if you make the favorable trade. I feel like if you're playing Sylvanas alongside this, for example, or if you're coining Ancient of Lore, then the potential for your rogue opponent to just dagger up, hit the 5-5 minion, and sorry, deadly poison up, hit the 5-5 minion, and then flurry the whole board away is pretty devastating. But Ryzen is going to decide. Wow, he's going to heal
the Shade.
Okay. That's awesome. I really like this, actually. It's not a play that I considered, I'll be perfectly honest, but he does have the Drake in play. So, Drake in hand, so he has the option for card draw, doesn't necessarily need the card. So this is an awesome line to take here to play around Blade Flurry.
Yeah, I really like this. I mean, we can see the hand, obviously. We know that the Blade Flurry isn't there for the punish, but 6-0 does have a fan of knives to cycle. So he had 2 draws to try and hit it. Does have a sap now finally for this Shade. Use the SI7, so a little bit unfortunate that heal on the Ancient of Lore isn't going to really work out for him.
Yeah, and unfortunately the combination of backstab and deadly poison as well does just result in a full clear here. So 6-0 has managed to get into that situation where the tempo has been swung entirely in one turn, which is what the rogue needs to do. And from a pretty disgusting looking position for him, to be honest, he's managed to get in a decent position. Even though he's low on resources, he does have that prep sprint to refill on a future turn.
Yeah, and if there's something not too threatening coming down from Ryzen here, you'd think he'd look for the prep spread straight away if possible.
Azir Drake, probably the weakest turn that we've seen from Ryzen this turn, and to his detriment, it's the turn after Rogue has probably had their best turn so far. And the fact that there is a weak follow-up gives 6-0 that breathing room that he needs to do the prep sprint combo. Get into a ton more resources here. He'll be looking for potentially another 3-drop here to play. Looks like he's going to go for the Phantom Knives instead. Just clear out this Drake. And he's back in the same position. 3-3 against an empty board as he was in the previous turn.
Yeah, this is nice for 6-0, being able to use that Phantom Knives. It's nice to have that insurance when you prep sap, that even though you've only got one other card in hand, it's a card which is perfectly acceptable to use after the prep sap. So even if you're prep sap...
Sprint, right? Prep sprint.
Yeah, sorry, yep. The prep sprint.
Yep.
So after you've used the prep sprint, you have a card in hand already that is perfectly fine to use,
yes.
even if you whiff on the prep sprint for a 3-mana card to play.
Yeah, sure thing. Double Tomb Pillager is coming into the hand at a pretty nice time, because it's starting to get to the point now where he's going to want to build up a board of his own, but he does still need to find a removal option for this board. No Blade Flurry has been drawn as of yet, which would be pretty fantastic right here with the dagger up and the Tinker Sharpsword Oil, but he's just going to have to Drake here to try and dig for the board. No answer to this Shade and Drake this turn, so a combo draw here is in fact lethal, I believe. Second Savage Roar doesn't do it, though.
19-20 with the hero power, right?
7 plus 6 twice. Yeah, 20 damage.
So just a little bit short here for Ryzen. What does he do here to clear up this board?
I mean, he's just seen a Farseer used, so if he feels like that's the healing exhausted from Sixo's deck, and we haven't seen a lot of Healbot being played in this tournament for sure,
no.
Rogue. So he can just go ahead and deal that 20 damage this turn, and then he has the 2 damage on the follow-up with the Keeper of the Grove that will beat all options. It will beat Taunt, it will beat Lotheb as well. But the other concern there is just the threat of dying straight back from your opponent, because there is 10 damage on board for them at the moment as well.
Yeah, it's one of those positions as casters that's really hard to predict or talk about the pro mindset, because we have the perfect information of the hands, right? But if you're in Ryzen's situation, Sixo could be sitting on, you know, oil prep flurry, for example, or
yeah,
any kind of combination of crazy damage. So I don't mind the respect here at all. Trading away the shade as well.
Wow. So I guess that means he's just trying to push this game a little bit longer and just rely on that Force of Nature draw when it comes to be able to seal the game. But honestly, based on the information that I've got from the Rogue deck so far in this tournament, it's unlikely that there would be any more healing in the opponent's hand. Most people have seemed to be just very light on healing with their Rogue decks in this tournament. So I was definitely looking at the all-in play with the damage there if we'd counted it correctly, and it was in fact 20.
Well, we both counted it, so we think that it was, yeah.
It was 7, plus 2 Savage Roars, which were both fireballs, so 6 damage, which is 19, plus the hero power is 20, so...
Yeah.
I was a really big fan of that play. I can't hand on my heart say that sight unseen without seeing my opponent's hand, I'd be brave enough to make that play, but it's the play that jumped out at me when I looked at the start of the turn straight away, without even really considering the options that I could see in 6-0's hand, so...
Sixo's gonna look at the Doctor Room here, and I assume the hero card to clear the Drake, maybe? Or is he gonna trade the 4-4? I think he's gonna trade the 4-4. He has the value of his life total with the Sylvanas on board, and that is not quite it, right?
It's 21. The choice to not use his life total there has paid out, because that is 14 plus 5 plus 2, which is 21 last time I checked. So 1 damage here off here from Ryzen. Again, he has the option to just do it and have the Keeper of the Grove as the follow-up. This time there's a little bit less damage on board than there was the previous turn. He's also gained 1 additional armor, but the Big Game Hunter Shredder play this turn actually just feels incredibly powerful. Feels a lot more powerful than what he did last turn, as opposed to going for the all-in play, so I'm definitely on board with his line this time.
Well, there's the flurry, though.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, so he can hit into the Sylvanas here, and I mean he can do the deadly poison Tinker's Blade Flurry if he wants.
He can, but the problem is for the guaranteed clear he has to hit the Shredder with his face. He can rely on the Boombot to take care of things for him afterwards, but in order to get the guaranteed clear, he is going to have to hit that Shredder first, which isn't going to be good enough based on the hand that we see.
So yeah, so if the Boombot hits the Shredder, there's no way for Ryzen to get the lethal here.
Right. But he can't even, so, you know, you could just buff your dagger, flurry, and then attack into the Shredder drop afterwards, but that's not an option that's available because of the fact that the Sylvanas is on board. So if you flurry and kill the Sylvanas beforehand... Ooh! Does choose to attack, gonna use the Boombot to take care of the Sylvanas afterwards. And that is going to be Ryzen through.
Thank you.
Callum. To what? Where is he?
To the final. He's in the final. He has the combo. 6-0, who Druid memed Kranich 3 games in a row.
Damn.
In our first game of the day.
Damn, that dance, though, from Ryzen. This is
I think that was a dab, actually. if you follow your American football. Yep, he is dabbing. That is what's happening.
I have no idea what that is. I don't watch sports that were invented to sell adverts. So
that's a meme for the American viewers, I think.
Okay, all right. Well, I hope they all appreciated it, because I have no idea.
I appreciated it. As an American football fan, I did appreciate that. But Ryzen makes it to the final, takes out our prediction of 6-0 making it all the way. Wow.
Hey, I have never been happier to be wrong in my life.
No, absolutely. I mean, this is your team.
very deserving finalist. Happy to see him doing well in this tournament. Obviously, a certain element of unavoidable bias from my part, because I want to see Complexity succeeding and doing well, but hard to say that he hasn't earned his spot here in the finals.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the victory over Orange in particular, the 3-0 with Rogue, I think, you know, obviously the show victory was really impressive as well, but just to blow out with that deck, that Rogue that he's, say, you know, he's practiced so much with, he's played so much with, really showed his mastery of it, really to me signaled that he was someone to be taken very seriously. And taking a 6-0 in an online tournament when 6-0 has played in so many of these,
yeah.
Ryzen has played in so few, 6-0 is one of the very best players in Europe. This is a huge, huge upset for Ryzen to make it to the final. Making it to the final is already a huge achievement for Ryzen, but you can bet he wants to go on better.
Oh, yeah. He wants to show the world right now that we are not a one-man team. Super JJ is not the only Complexity player that's capable of beating the best and winning tournaments. He wants to break out, really pick up his big win, and he's in a great position to do so, but he now awaits the winner of the other semi-final, and one thing is for sure, Callum, he's going to have a tough opponent in the final.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be... He's going to have to go up against another European great. He's going to have to go up against either Life Coach or Hoi. Mm-hmm. Of course, Life Coach, we talked about, one of the most decorated players in all of Hearthstone. Hoi, a very talented player in his own right. Hasn't necessarily shown his very best play here, particularly that mistake in the Warlock game,
yeah,
against Soleil. Mm-hmm. And didn't look too comfortable against Jab in the first round as well. Mm-hmm. He's going to be looking to prove himself against Life Coach, but either of those opponents are going to be a very tough one for Ryzen.
Yeah, for sure. Not much more we can say about either Life Coach or Hoi at this point. We've evangelized them both to the best of our substantial abilities, Callum. So it's going to be a hugely exciting matchup. I'm looking forward to seeing the outcome of it after this break. But we just wait and see, I guess. Either way, Ryzen is going to have an uphill struggle.
Absolutely. You're, of course, watching the Wombology Tournament, which is brought to you by Wombo.gg, where you can play money matches against your friends and the pros in all manner of esports game, and Screenshoe.com. Make sure you're checking those out in this short break, and we will see you in just a couple of minutes for our second semi-final, Hoi versus Life Coach. Don't go anywhere.